I'd like to start with a brief discussion of the concept of academic colonialism. As we all know, we were considered as one type of cultural colonialism. Initially, the colonials would arrive with direct violence to conquer our body. Then it followed by structural violence to constrain our behavior. In the end, it would be cultural violence to enslave our mind so that we all will become happy slaves. Indigenous scholar in Taiwan are confronting challenges in three ways. In addition to Western knowledge, they also face Han chauvinism, as well as the violent appropriation by the anthropologists. They consider this is their territory. Okay. Now I'll talk about the abuse of academic brokerage in Taiwan in the process of from starting from academic colonialism through academic dependency to academic new colonialism. Psychologically, Taiwanese scholars, they are not only passive and inactive, they also have a deep complex of inferiority in the sense that they refrain from autonomous thinking. From time to time, if we contribute paper to a domestic journal, then some polite reviewer will say, would you please provide for a reference in English? And then some rude one will say, if your research is really that good, why don't you submit your paper in the West so that we know you from abroad? Okay. So we did try sometime, but then the Western editor-in-chief would say, well, Professor Shih, your article is interesting, but you know it lacks readership. Why don't you submit your paper at home? Okay, so we are thrown back to Taiwan again. So let's see. This professor, Taiwanese professor, would have to seek the approval from their former Western advisor. Therefore, there is a saying in Taiwan, only foreign monk can preach, especially white one. Okay. Some professor seems to enjoy the status of the sole importer of certain knowledge. A few full professors even have gone so far as to serve as willing research assistant to their former advisor, in the sense that they are willing to process the data given to them. Okay. Then I'll talk about the obsession and the abuse of the three I, SSCI, SSCI, and A and HCI. About 10 years ago, the government, including the Ministry of Education and the National Science Council, began to evaluate university in terms of the productivity accumulated from the three indexes. Okay. Within university, these three indicators are crucial criteria for promotion as well as bonus. And so the system is highly biased against humanity and social scientists because those in natural science, medical science, they have common language universally. And they can easily get their paper published in the West. I heard that some professors, they don't know how to write article. They can just submit their data and somebody will process the data into article. And then somebody would translate that into English. So that's how they get the SSCI, SCI. Okay. And also, there's also a trick. Sometimes they have more than 5 or 7 or 10 cohorts. Mm-hmm. It's just like economic multiplier. Okay. Now, the problem is that the young scholar, they lost interest in issues crucial to our country. Okay. About 5 years ago, the Ministry of Education began to distribute about 1 billion to about 10 so-called research excellence universities in the period of 5 years, so that they can enter the top 100 universities in the world. Okay, this year, the first review has popped up. It is discovered that in average, we have 2 more articles appearing either in Science or Nature every year. Wow, that's so expensive. Mm-hmm. Why don't we just hire some academic mercenary from the West? Well, I'm not the Minister of Education. Then I'll talk about my career as Dean of College of Indigenous Studies in the past 3 years. The college was established 10 years ago under the pressures of political activists and MP. And the university accepted the offer, calculating that both the Ministry of Education and the Council of Indigenous People promised to have 3 buildings constructed to the university. And they think, even if the monk can take off, but they would have the temple intact, you know, so that they can translate our conference into a college of social science or something like that. Okay. At that time, I was asked my indigenous friend to take over the position so that it would be taken over by other people. At that time, I have met a lot of obstacles. First of all, institutionally, the program was disorganized. It's a small college, but there were 3 departments, 3 graduate institutes, and 1 center. So I had to consolidate them into 3 departments. Of course, I met a lot of resistance. You know, there are so many colonels and so many generals with too few foot soldiers. Okay. Then the curricula were chaotic. You know, it was designed to be a department store. Instead, at worst, it looked like street vendor. At most, it's not like, you know, food stand in the night market. Okay. So each professor had their own territory. Then I had to consolidate them. And somebody boycott. So I enlist my indigenous colleague. We teach 101. Okay, huge class. Okay. Then the third one was that we were losing students. When I moved in, only about 80% of the number of enrollment were filled up. So I took the brand. Then the most important challenge came from the university. The chancellor was not supportive. You see, in the beginning, after brief and happy encounter between the Ministry of Education and the Council of Indigenous People, you know, they decided to give up the child. You know, the pop was not responsible, and the mom doesn't like the kid. So the headmaster of the orphanage said, Mr. Dean Shih, you have been losing money because the university have to have some kind of tuition waiver to the Indigenous student. So how come? So, you know, it's become some kind of business.
Okay.
Also, initially we have five buildings, and the university only allow us to use two buildings, unless we can get some money to pay for the electricity.
Okay.
Well, then, you know, we have problem about our linguistic program, that kind of course. In Taiwan, in elementary school, as long as there is one student demanding the course, the school has to provide for the class. But in our university, the minimum number is 10. So only those large tribes can afford to this kind of course. And then our students have to pass English proficiency test. And we ask, why not we have substitute our indigenous linguistic proficiency for that one? But then, you know, our authority will say that you don't have the privilege to have special treatment. Okay. So what did I do? I did have a good start. First of all, at that time, the party, indigenous MP froze the budget of the university. So we now we play the role of good cop and bad cop. Okay, they put pressure to the university. Okay, I convinced the chancellor that I can undertake some reform in terms of reorganization and the restructure of the curriculum, and I avoid former confrontation with him. And also, I distanced myself to power struggle within the university. But from time to time, I would try to forge a coalition with some minor colleges, like a College of Arts, College of Environmental Study, and College of Education. I stood up and speak for them. Okay. And also, I had to disregard former assault from those huge colleges like natural science and engineering, okay, and also humanity and social science. So they are colonialists too, okay, social scientists sometimes. Okay. And within my college, you know, my college, they guard their territory. So I have to buy off some and neglect a few, then coerce a couple. Okay. And outside the university, as I mentioned it earlier, well, I was a political activist. And I helped the MP solicit support from them. And also, I appear on Indigenous TV, and I wrote commentary from time to time. So I look like a bully. Okay. Then, what I have accomplished so far, in addition to organizational and curricular reform and consolidation, the most important accomplishment is that I have enhanced our teaching staff. In the beginning, when I moved in, there was less than one third of our colleagues were though they were indigenous people. Now I have successfully recruited 4 people. Okay. In the past 8 years, nobody got promotion, and I helped 8 assistant professor promoted to associate professor, 1 associate to full professor. And then about student enrollment, in the second year, the number of applicants has risen to 700%, the largest. And the second one will be the Department of History, 250%. Then the rest decreased the numbers of applicants. But the chancellor was curious how it had happened. Okay, maybe because of my appearance on TV.